अस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। नमस्कार टू ऑल ऑफ यू। वेलकम टू द स्टडी ऑफ लाइफ ऑफ शारदानंद जी महाराज, हु इज द ऑथर ऑफ द ग्रेट मास्टर श्री रामकृष्ण। यू ऑलमोस्ट इन द एंड ऑफ द life of Sharadanand ji Maharaj, we may take another three or four classes and we may finish it. Swami Sharadananda called himself the mother's, that is Holy Mother Sharada Devi's doorkeeper. He felt proud of the position. From his small room at the left of the entrance to the master's house in Calcutta, from his small room at the left of the entrance to the mother's house in Calcutta, he kept an eye on the devotees who went upstairs to salute her. It was not an easy task. So he used to work there as a doorkeeper. And also he used to be proud of that. So you have to note it here, a very important thing. Sharadananda called himself the mother's doorkeeper. And he felt proud of the position. Now, what is there? So important that I'm stressing it again and again and telling it. We have a speciality, a spiritual factor here, which we have to note. Many people will be asking me the question, how to overcome ego? Ego is troubling us. What is the way by which we can remove our ego? So I always remind them of the words of Sri Ramakrishna. Ramakrishna used to tell, ego is Maya. Ego is the cause of all miseries. Ego is the cause of all problem. It's very difficult to remove it. This moment you may think I have removed the ego, and the very next day it is there, spreading its tentacles. It's just like the Ashwatha Vriksha. It is just like the tree, people tree. You cut it to the root and the next day it will be already sprouting. It will be a new tree will be coming there. So ego is like that. Immediately it will sprout, it will come in different form and put us into trouble. So then what is the way? So Ramakrishna himself points out, the way to remove ego is divert it. Now there are two types of ego. One is called Kacha Ami and Paka Ami. The first one is Kacha Ami, which is all we are having, the unripened ego. We have this unripened ego. I am born to such and such a family. We have that surname. My father is a policeman. My father is a lawyer. My mother is that, educated in this way. So I have this qualification. I have this kind of a wife or a husband or this kind of children. You identify the greatness. Oh, my child did like this, like that. So these are all associated with unripened ego. I have so much bank balance. I have so much money. I have so many vehicles. I have this collection of clothes. I have this collection of slippers, jewelry, all that identification with these things, material things, is unripened ego. Then how to overcome that unripened ego? Turn it towards God. So then it becomes ripened ego. Let that ego, the rascal ego, remain, but let it be remaining there as the servant of God, the son of God, the child of God, the friend of God. So in that way, turn that ego, associate that with God, then the very unripened ego will become the ripened ego. How is that? Can we get some example from Sharadanandaji's life? Yes, Sharadanandaji is feeling proud. Mother, the pride, the mother, garva. So garva means pride. So he is feeling the pride, or he is feeling proud, mother. So when we get too much of things which we aspire for, the desires are fulfilled, then we get mother. So the mother is here taking the form of, I am the servant of mother, divine mother. So Sharadananda called himself the mother's doorkeeper. He is very proud to call himself the doorkeeper, the servant of divine mother Sharada Devi, and he felt proud of that position. So that is the way by which we can transform the unripened ego to the ripened ego. My father is Narayana, Vishnu. He is the slayer of such and such demons, the great rowdies, the great notorious terrorists. Do you know who my father is? My father is Narayana, my father is Vishnu. My father is Ramakrishna, who is the avatar of Gadadhar Vishnu. You know who my father is? My father is Lord Shiva. Do you know who my mother is? My mother is Divine Mother Parvati, Rajarajeshwari. Do you know who my mother is? My mother is Sharada Devi, who is the avatar of Lakshmi Saraswati according to Ramakrishna. So in this way, if you change your association, if you change your identity with the ego, that very ego which is troubling you, which is unripened and puts you into misery, which is Maya, can be given a sattvic turn by associating with the Divine Mother, with the Lord. So the whole thing pattern changes. So here the clue is given by Sharadanandaji, how to change the unripened ego to the ripened ego. So I think many people have this problem, how to overcome ego. We are all having this ego. How to change this ego? How to suppress ego? Many people will be asking, we want to remove that ego. We want to destroy that ego. I tell them, why do you want to destroy? Don't destroy it. Allow it to grow. Let it grow. Then sacrifice it. Bali, bali. Give that as a bali. Sacrifice it at the altar of the Divine Mother. Just like the bakra or the goat or the hen is given bali. They cut it in front of the altar of Divine Mother, the temple, just like cut your ego. That is to be cut. In reality, what is the practice? The practice of cutting animals is nothing but it is symbolical of you have to cut your ego. We have to downsize our ego. We have to destroy our ego at the field. Develop it. Develop your ego very nicely. Build it up. Then sacrifice it at the altar of Divine Mother or the Master. So that is the wonderful spiritual path to conquer ego, to convert ego into a good ego. To the ego can never be given up. You have to have ego until you have this life. Otherwise, the heart doesn't function, the body doesn't work without the ego. You could see in Samadhi, when there is no ego, the master heartbeat, everything, pulses, everything would stop. The doctor attested it, Dr. Mahendra Lal Sarkar. So ego used to be there for the functioning of your body and everything. So let that rascal ego, these are the words of Ramakrishna, let that rascal ego remain, but let him remain as a servant of God, the son of God, associate with God. Then it becomes ripened ego. So you can see how the ripened ego works. So Sharadananda called himself the Divine Mother Sharada Devi's doorkeeper, security guard. And he felt proud of that position. From his small room at the left of the entrance, if you go even now to Udbodhan, as soon as you enter Udbodhan, then on the left side, there is one small room. that small room was the place or the living space of Sharadanandaji Maharaj. He would sit there writing this book, Great Master, and also taking care of the people who are going to meet Mother Sharada Devi, who was upstairs in her room there. Present, the room of Sharada Devi is the shrine. It is on the first floor. So from a small room at the left of the entrance to the mother's house, he kept an eye on the devotees who went upstairs to salute her. That work was not an easy task. Once a devotee walked a great distance, he came from far off place to Udbodhan, this place. It was very, very hot, sultry. It was about 3 in the afternoon. Holy Mother Sharada Devi had just returned from a devotee's house and she had just gone to rest. Sharadananda said to the devotee who had come there from a distance, from far off place in that hot sun, and it was noon, 3 o'clock. Sharadananda said to the devotee, "Now mother is resting. I won't allow you to go up now. Mother is tired." With the words, that devotee who had come, he was not satisfied with these words. He became very angry and aggressive. What was his reply to Sharadananda? With the words, "Is Holy Mother Sharada Devi? Is she just your mother? She is also my mother. Don't I know that I can go to my mother anytime? Will my mother be upset if I go and disturb her rest? She is also my mother. She is not only your mother. She is also my mother. I can disturb her. I have the right to disturb my mother at any time. So with these words, is she your mother? Is she just your mother?" The visitor practically pushed Sharadananda aside and went upstairs. Very soon, after going up pushing Sharadananda, he felt repentant for his rash act and prayed that he might avoid the Swami while going out. After meeting mother and doing pranams to mother while coming down, he felt repentant. He felt he was very rash towards that Swami. So he wanted to avoid, because he not only spoke very rashly to Sharadananda, but also he pushed him aside. Very soon he felt repentant for his rash act and prayed that he might avoid the Swami while going out. He also told that Mother Sharada Devi, also told, reported that to Mother Sharada Devi about his improper conduct, that he behaved with Sharadananda in this manner. I pushed him. I was very rash to him and I came up. So he also told this to mother about the improper conduct, but she was reassured by Holy Mother, the all-forgiving Holy Mother reassured him, "Don't worry, nothing will happen to you, don't worry." The Holy Mother reassured that person sheepishly. He came down the stairs and found Sharadanandaji Maharaj seated in the same place, because there is no other exit. That is the only exit. If you have to go out of the Udbodhan, there is no other way. That is the only exit. So whichever direction you go, then if you have to go out of the Udbodhan house, you have to come through that place where Sharadanandaji used to sit. Sheepishly, he came down the stairs and found Sharadananda seated in the same place. He asked his forgiveness now for the offense. Now it was the turn of Sharadananda. He embraced that person, the devotee. He embraced him. See the way he has been rudely pushed aside. Sharadananda has been rudely pushed aside, and even he has used him harsh words, but see the reaction of Sharadananda. See that titiksha, sahanam sarvadukkanam apratikara purvakam, no revengeful attitude, chinta vilaparahitam, not worrying, no grumbling, that is negative, withstanding and bearing and forbearing. But what is the positive aspect? Forgiving, that is little positive. What is much more positive? Appreciating and embracing him. He embraced that devotee and said in a manner of appreciation to him. And what was that? Why do you talk about offending me? I have not been offended. Can one see God? Can one see Divine Mother without such yearning? If you didn't have that yearning, if you didn't have that, use that anger. See, at some places Ramakrishna is permitted. You can use your tamas to get the vision of God. What is the tamas? How can you use even tamas? Tamas is lethargic and anger and all the other bad negative qualities is tamas. In the three qualities of the nature, sattva, rajas and tamas, rajas is activity, but tamas is inactivity, lethargy, and also the himsa, cruelty, then all the other bad qualities you can see, anger, all this belongs to tamas. Now, how to use tamas for God realization? Ramakrishna used to tell, you have to go and fight with the Divine Mother. Do you know who I am? I am the child of you, Kali, who is the destroyer. I am not afraid of you. Will you give me darshan? Or see what I am going to do to you. Won't you give me darshan? Won't you give me your vision? Or else see what I am going to do to you. There is a song which Ramakrishna used to sing to Divine Mother. There is a yoga in astrological calculation. In that particular yoga, it is called Ganda Yoga. Karana Yoga, Galige, all these things are different astrological times. So there is a yoga or the junction of the time, astrological, this junction of stars and planets, that's called Ganda Yoga. A baby which is born in that Ganda Yoga, as soon as it is born, the mother who has given birth to the that baby will die. That is called Ganda Yoga. In astrological calculation, when the baby is born, when the child is born, in that particular time, inauspicious time, Ganda Yoga, then the mother who has given birth to that baby is to die. She has to die. Or there will be some yogas where the father has to die or something like that. It's inauspicious. So that song goes to proclaim, do you know Mother Kali? Ramakrishna used to sing this song, tamasic way of approaching. Do you know Mother Kali? Who I am? I am born in the Ganda Yoga. I am a child who is born in the Ganda Yoga who will eat the mother. Eating the mother means killing the mother. Mother will die as soon as the baby is born. So I am born in the Ganda Yoga. So that such a child will eat the mother, it seems. I am going to eat you now. I will open my mouth. Oh Kali. So that Mother Kali is addressing Mother Kali, that poet. The devotee is addressing, oh Mother Kali, I am the eater of mother. You are my mother. I am the child who is born in that Ganda Yoga. I am going to eat you up with my mouth agape. I am going to eat you up. Will you eat me or shall I eat you? Either you are also a very bad mother, destroying the whole world. You will eat up all the demons, you will eat up all the bad people. You have a big mouth, you have big tongue, you have big carnivorous tooth. You are also cruel. You are going to kill and eat everybody, isn't it? Come, either I will eat you or you eat me. So that is the challenge given by the devotee in that beautiful song. So Ramakrishna used to song, that is the tamasic attitude, fighting with God, quarreling with God. Will you do that to me? Will you give me darshan? Are you not going to give me darshan? Or see what I am going to do? So fight with God. So that is a tamasic attitude. So in some places Ramakrishna tells, when the Lord doesn't give you darshan, you have to use your tamas. You can fight with God. You have all the rights to fight. because he is your father, he is your mother. So since he is your mother, is the closest, the God is your mother, God is your father, so you have the right to ask for your property, ask for your rights, demand whatever you want from mother. So you can use the sometimes, not always, use the tamas also. So here, he had used his tamas, anger, to go towards the Divine Mother, have the vision of mother. So here, Sharadanandaji Maharaj has so much of patience, so much of forgiving nature. Not only did he forgive, not only did he could have cursed him, he could have got angry on him, he could have also, he was very strong, he could have pushed him. But see the attitude, see the approach. Not only he was not revengeful, not only he was not cursing or grumbling, having that titiksha, sahanam, forbearing, forgiving, but positively he appreciated him and he embraced him. The devotee embraced, when he was repentant, was asking for forgiveness. When the devotee sheepishly, when he was coming down with feeling of guilt conscience, found Sharadanandaji Maharaj seated in the same place, he wanted to escape from him, run away from him, he wanted to avoid him, but he couldn't. So he asked forgiveness for the offense. Sharadananda immediately embraced him and said, "Why do you talk about offending me? I have not been offended." And positively is telling, can anyone see the Divine Mother without such yearning, without such vyakulata, without such intensity? If you didn't have, if you had an namby-pamby attitude, you would have told sheepishly, yes, okay, I will stop here, I will go back and come another day. You would have not had the vision at all. Because of your zeal, because of your that strong attitude, you could go and see mother. So he appreciated him, appreciated his quality. Why do you talk about offending me? Can one see Divine Mother without such yearning? See the way of forgiveness, see the way of appreciation, such a fine quality. So we all know when somebody offends us, insults us, either if you are strong, we will give back, fight back. We will either scold them rashly or even we may beat them. That is the one way. Suppose you are weak, you cannot, he is your boss, he is stronger than you. Then you keep quiet at that time. But within you will be burning, you will be wanting or waiting for an opportunity to put him down or insult him or speak him behind the back and spread calumny against him. Thirdly, if you can't do that too, then what will you be doing? You'll be grumbling, you'll be cursing him within, you'll be, the fire of worry will be burning you, you'll be cursing him always, you'll be remembering the same act again and again, and you'll be punishing yourself. So these are all the things which can happen in anybody's life. But see the way Sharadanandaji Maharaj has given up his ego, not only given up his ego, but how positively he sees the Atman, the Lord everywhere, takes every aspect of life, whether favorable or unfavorable, whether insult or reward or respect, everything can be converted into an offering to God. You can divinize it. And Sharadanandaji Maharaj is showing the path. Even the insult, even the scolding, even the rash pushing of that devotee was just an ordinary devotee. And a young person, Sharadanandaji is senior. He is a direct disciple of Ramakrishna. He has done so much of sadhana. He has realized God. He had had samadhi, the highest realization. Ramakrishna himself used to respect him, telling, your attitude is, you have to think yourself as Shiva. And you have to think me as the Shakti. And that is the path. Vivekananda used to respect him. Holy Mother Sharada Devi used to call him as Vasuki. My snake, the divine snake, protecting with all his hood, how it would protect Lord Vishnu, like that he is protecting me. Such a person, such a high spiritual stature, He knows his value, but at the same time, see the mercy, see the kindness, see the forgiveness. And not only that, how he is taking every aspect of his life, whether insult or reward, in the positive stride and seeing God in that person too. And he is appreciating him and he is inspiring him to be like that. Why do you talk about offending me? I have not been offended at all. Can one see Divine Mother without such yearning? If you had not pushed me and gone up to see the Holy Mother, would you get the divine vision? Such yearning should be there. He's even appreciating and praising him. The wrong deed of his is also, he's removing his guilt conscience and teaching him that you should have such faith and you should have such yearning for God. On another occasion, when Sharda Devi was ill, a devotee came to her and prayed for initiation. She is sick and she is bedridden. But this wonderful devotee came and was praying for initiation, mantra diksha. So for that preparation has to be made. And when you are sick, if you give initiation for hours together, you have to sit and meditate, you have to do puja. Then you have to accept the sin of the disciple. So that will make her more sick. So now he, even though he seeing mother is sick down in the bed, he's praying her for initiation. Holy Mother asked him to come a few days later, but the devotee insisted. As this devotee insisted, Holy Mother Sharda Devi asked him to speak to Shardananda about it. Then the devotee again told, I do not know anybody here. I do not know who is Shardananda, anybody else. I know only you. He insisted again, I have come to you. You are the mother. I have come to you. Please initiate me. Why should I go to Shardananda? You are my mother. I know you. So I don't know any Shardananda and other people. I have come to you, he insisted again, please initiate me. To which Holy Mother Sharda Devi replied, what do you mean? Replied, Holy Mother, Sharat is the jewel of my head. See, what is the attitude of Holy Mother towards Sharat? Sharat, that Shardananda is the jewel of my head. See, what is the topic on Tuesday we are studying? Krish, jewel of discrimination. So that is Viveka Chudamani. Chudamani means the crushed jewel. The jewel, the diamond, which is kept on the crown, head. That's called crushed jewel, Chudamani. So the diamond, the biggest diamond stolen from India, Kohinoor diamond, is always kept on the head of the Queen of England. So that is the crushed jewel. The Chudamani, in Sanskrit it's called Chudamani. So now Holy Mother Sharda Devi is praising. What do you mean that you do not know Shardananda? Sharat, Shardananda is the jewel of my head. What he says will be done. If he says yes, if he says mother will give initiation, I am going to give. If he says mother is not going to give initiation, I will not give. He is the jewel of my head. What he says will be done. That was the faith in Shardananda by Holy Mother Sharda Devi. Now, after the strong words of Holy Mother, the devotee went to Shardananda, who fixed a day for his initiation. So now we can see, what was the respect, what was the place given by Mother Sharda Devi to Sharat or Shardananda? She is stating that Sharat is my jewel of my head. I have placed him even above my head. Such is the place to Sharat in my life, Divine Mother Sharda Devi is telling. In spite of all Holy Mother's affection and confidence in him, in spite of the respect, in spite of the confidence and Holy Mother Sharda Devi's affection in Sharadananda, in spite of all these things, Sharadananda was the very image of humility. The more respect, the more deeper the place and confidence of Holy Mother towards him, the more it made him humbler and humbler. He was even humbler than the blade of grass. In India it is used. We should be humbler than the blade of grass. So, in spite of that high place, the respect shown by Holy Mother towards Sharadananda, in spite of the confidence which Ramakrishna had in him, in spite of all the way Vivekananda and other disciples treated Sharadananda, he was such a great soul, he knew who he was, but never would he show his ego or anger. He would be always that humble person. Sharadananda was very image of humility. In spite of Holy Mother's affection and confidence in him, Sharadananda was the very image of humility. We have to learn even a small thing, small amount of money in the bank makes us so proud, so egoistic. One new boot, you have a special boot, wearing that you start whistling and jumping from the stairs. So you get some position in your workplace, a little promotion, we become so much egoistic and start behaving in a very different way to other people. We forget our humble beginning. But on the contrary, see here Sharadanandaji Maharaj. He has got the highest place, he has got the highest respect by the Divine Mother herself, by the great Narayana Vishnu himself gave him such respect. But he was the image of humility. This is what a spiritual aspirant should be. This is what the spiritual aspirant should develop. So these are the qualities which we as spiritual aspirant, while going forward in spiritual life, we should give up our ego. That is the main obstacle. That is the main destroyer of spiritual life. That is Maya. Ego is Maya. So many things to learn from this wonderful spiritual personality called Sharadananda. In spite of all Holy Mother's affection and confidence in Sharadananda, Sharadananda was the very image of humility. Some people are the very image of ego. We sometimes can see some people, the way they talk, the way they behave, they are just bundle of ego. Nothing can we see in them. We cannot see their nose or head or leg or feet. We can see they are just a bulk, a lump of ego. So that should be the egoistic behavior of such people with everybody. They are just a lump of ego. But here, Sharadanandaji Maharaj is the very image of humility. A disciple of Mother Sharda Devi on one occasion took the dust of his feet. A person who is initiated by Holy Mother Sharda Devi, is a disciple of Holy Mother Sharda Devi, on one occasion came and took the dust of the feet of Sharadananda. You know what is taking the dust of the feet? We go, suppose there is some senior person, elderly person or a respectable person. The tradition in India is we touch the feet or we touch even more humility. Wherever that person was standing, where his foot touched the ground. So we take the dust of that place. We touch that place where his foot stood and take the dust and touch it to our head. That is a way of showing our humility. So by doing that, our ego will be destroyed. What is the reason we do pranams? That is also another way of showing our humility, removing the ego. This is another way. They go touch that place where that person was standing. The dust is taken and put on the head. That is another way of showing our humility. Then immediately our ego will be removed. When your ego is removed, what happens? God, who is already present with you in view, will be manifested. Why do we do namaskar? Why do we do the panchanga namaskar with 5 limbs? Why do we do sashtanga, 8 limbs namaskar? Why do we do dirghadanda namaskar? All that namaskar we do in front of the God is, it is removal of ego. You are showing humility. You are showing your great respect to that person or God or Guru. Then immediately your ego will be destroyed. It will be vanished for the time being. So the moment ego is moved out, because of our ego, we don't do pranams. Because of our ego, we don't bow down our head in front of the elders, parents, or the Guru, or God, or in the temple, because of the ego. So, setting aside the ego, your prestige and the pride, you're bowing down, you are taking the dust of another person. That means you are humbling yourself. The moment you do all these things, what happens is, your ego is pushed away for the time being. So when the ego goes away, what remains in you is God. You are nothing but God. You are nothing but the Nijaswarupa, the true essence of yourself is God, Parabrahma Swarupa, infinite consciousness, absolute, infinite existence, absolute, infinite bliss, absolute. You are that Lord yourself. The moment you push away ego, then Lord is manifested. That is the reason why we do pranams. That is the reason why we take the dust of the feet of any great seniors, the Guru, elders. So, once a devotee of Holy Mother Sharada Devi, he came and on one occasion he took the dust of the feet of Sharadananda, perhaps with a little show. So he wanted to show off a little, perhaps with a little show, as the Swami was about to begin his daily duties. The Swami said, why are you doing such a big salutation? Why are you doing this drama, so much of salutation? Why can't you do it ordinarily? Why are you showing off so much? Why such a big salutation? What is the idea? What do you want from me? Then that devotee replied, sir, why do you say that? The disciple replied, whom else should I salute but you? To which Swami Sharadananda replied, I am seated here waiting for the grace of Holy Mother Sharada Devi, by whom you have been blessed or initiated. If she wishes, if Divine Mother Sharada Devi, from whom you are initiated, if she wishes, she can this very moment seat you in my position. Do you know how powerful Mother Sharada Devi is? She has hidden. You can't understand who Mother Sharada Devi is. She is behaving like a ordinary village, uneducated, illiterate woman. But in reality, she is Raja Rajeshwari, the highest divine mother. She is acting as if she is an ordinary woman, illiterate woman, a village woman. But in reality, she is the highest divine mother. Come down to the earth to save people. I know that. If she wishes in this second, if she wants, if she wishes this second, she can remove me from this place and can seat you, make you that raise to that level of Sharadananda. I'm nothing. I'm also waiting here to get her grace. I'm waiting like a servant. I know how great is Mother Sharada Devi. So I'm waiting upon her, serving her like a servant, like a security guard, doing her whatever little bit service, waiting for her grace. I am waiting for her grace. And you have been initiated by her. And how great is she? If she wishes this second, this moment, you can be seated in my place. So great she is. I am just waiting for her grace here. That was what Sharadanandaji told about Mother Sharada Devi. A disciple of Holy Mother Sharada Devi on an occasion took the dust of Sharadananda's feet, perhaps with a little show, as Swami Sharadananda was about to begin his daily duties. Swami Sharadananda said, "Why such a big salutation? What is the idea?" To which the disciple of Sharada Devi told, "Sir, why do you say that?" The disciple replied, whom else should I salute but you?" The Swami said again in reply, "I am seated here awaiting her grace by whom you have been blessed. If she wishes, she can this very moment seat you in my place." When Sharadananda prostrated himself before Holy Mother Sharada Devi, as a witness observed, it was an unusual sight. What was unusual? The way Sharadananda used to do prostration, fall down like a stick, Dirgadanda Pranama, so much of humility. He used to do pranams with so much of humility. When Sharadananda prostrated himself before Holy Mother, as a witness observed, it was an unusual sight. Sharadananda melted, as it were, on the ground before Mother Sharada Devi. Because Vivekananda, Sharadananda, all other people knew who really Sharada Devi was. So, now a devotee who has seen Sharadananda prostrating before Holy Mother, he is explaining, the witness who saw Sharadananda bowing down or doing prostration to Holy Mother Sharada Devi, it was an unusual sight. Swami Sharadananda, while prostrating before Mother, it looked as if he melted, as it were, on the ground before Mother Sharada Devi. He showed that with his salutation he offered at her feet, his body he offered at her feet while saluting. What is the real thing you have to do? See, again, another lesson Sharadanandaji is giving us here. While we prostrate to God, while we do the pranam, whatever you do, pranam, panchanga, five limbs, just bowing down half, or sashtanga, eight limbs touching the ground, or dirghadanda pranama, just like a stick falling on the ground, what should be your inner attitude? Outwardly you may be feigning, you may be acting humility, but inwardly what is your feeling? Nobody knows it. So what should be the inner transformation? Now you can see it in Sharadanandaji Maharaj's showing. So while prostrating, Sharadananda melted, as it were, on the ground before Holy Mother Sharada Devi. He showed that with his salutation. So now please note it, what we should do while we salute, while we do the prostration, while we do the pranama. What should be our inner transformation? What should be our inner attitude? Sharadananda showed that with his salutation, he offered at her feet, at Sharada Devi's feet, his body, his soul, and everything. He offered, while saluting Mother Sharada Devi, he offered his body, he offered his soul, Atman, he offered everything. That should be the inner attitude. The surrender is, you have to surrender, you have to offer everything to God. For over 15 years, Sharadananda had the unique privilege of being close to Holy Mother and looking after her needs. How small he felt in her presence. Once Sharadananda remarked What can we understand of Holy Mother Sharda Devi? This, however, I can say, I have never seen such a great mind like Mother Sharda Devi, and I do not hope to see one again. It is not within our capacity to comprehend the extent of Holy Mother's glory and power. I have never seen in anyone else such attachment, nor have I seen such detachment. What is the nature of a perfect mind? Swami Vivekananda tells, the mind should be ready to concentrate and focus and attach to something which it is focusing. And the very next moment, you also have to learn detachment too. Not only attachment, not only concentrating, not only focus. Once you focus, once you concentrate on something, the tendency of the mind, it will get attached to that and it will never come back. You cannot remove that attachment. But the real concentration or focus or the strength of the mind is, you have to intensely attach to something, concentrate and focus. But the very next moment, you should be ready to detach from that object also. So, Sharadanandaji Maharaj noticed that wonderful nature, the quality in the mind of Mother Sharda Devi. He's telling, Sharadananda is remarking, once Sharadananda remarked, what can we understand of Mother Sharda Devi? This, however, I can say about her, I have never seen, she is telling, I have never seen, that means not even Ramakrishna. We can't compare, they are one and the same. But the way he is telling, it was not so with even with Ramakrishna. I have never seen such a great mind like Sharda Devi. And I do not hope to see again, once again, impossible. Her mind control is the highest. It is not within our capacity to comprehend the extent of Holy Mother's glory and power. It is not in my capacity to understand the power and glory of Holy Mother Sharda Devi's mind. I have never seen in anyone such attachment, such focus, nor have I seen such detachment. She was so deeply attached to Radhu, her niece, because Ramakrishna had told, keeping her as your center, she is Yoga Maya, keep your mind on her and live in this world and you can do the work. She wanted to give up her body. She wanted to absorb herself in deep samadhi and give up the body after Ramakrishna went away. But Ramakrishna told, no, you have to do more work than me. So, keeping your mind attached to Radhu, the niece, you stay in this world and do the good to the world. So, Sharadanandaji Maharaj is telling, Mother Sharda Devi was deeply attached to Radhu, but before her death, she said, please send this Radhu away. Not even a trace of attachment towards that niece, whom she loved all her life. Radhu lost all attraction for her. Such was the intensity of detachment too. So she is showing in Vedanta, in Bhagavad Gita, everywhere in the Upanishad, in the Karma Yoga, it is told, detachment, detachment, vairagya, renunciation. So work in a disinterested way. Detachment, everywhere the word detachment will come. So you can see Mother Sharda Devi could detach her mind at will to such an extent that you can't even imagine. The whole life she had so much of attachment towards Radhu that very moment when she decided, I will take away her mind, she was completely detached. That is the perfect mind. That is the way the perfect mind behaves. Intense attachment, intense concentration, intense focus. But whenever the mind doesn't want, at will, you can detach. that very next second. A devotee once said to Sharadananda that he could easily believe in the divinity of Sri Ramakrishna. Once a devotee, he told Sharadananda that he could easily believe in the divinity of Sri Ramakrishna. At least he cherished that faith. But I cannot comprehend Holy Mother Sharada Devi as the Divine Mother. I don't believe, I don't get faith at all. She looks like a very ordinary woman, like a village woman, illiterate woman. Then immediately Swami Sharadananda replied, "Do you mean to say that the highest God Vishnu came down from Vaikuntha to this earth as an avatar and married the daughter of a village woman who maintained herself by gathering cow dung?" Do you think that Ramakrishna, who was the avatar of Vishnu, who came down to this earth and he married a very ordinary village woman, was collecting cow dungs, was making cow dung cakes? Do you think the avatar Purusha Ramakrishna married a cow dung collector? That was the reply. Never have doubt in Holy Mother Sharada Devi. Do you mean to say that God married the daughter of a woman who maintained herself by gathering cow dung? In 1909, Sharadananda began to write his monumental work, Sri Sri Ramakrishna Leela Prasanga in Bengali. So he started in 1909, which has been translated as Sri Ramakrishna, the Great Master, and which we completed just recently. It is not only that Sri Ramakrishna Leela Prasanga, the Great Master, is that great monumental work written by Sharadananda is not only an authentic interpretive biography of Sri Ramakrishna, but it is also a classic in Bengali literature. So in Bengali literature, that has become a classic literature. Such was the mastery with which Sharadananda has written. It consists of 5 volumes, and it took nearly 10 years for Sharadananda to complete that monumental work, the Great Master Sri Ramakrishna. Sharadananda gave 3 reasons for this great undertaking. Sharadananda gave 3 reasons why he took up this great undertaking. First, he wrote it to repay the loan or the debt, the money that he had borrowed to build Holy Mother's house, that is Udbodhan in Calcutta, and to publish Udbodhan. So the money needed to build the house and to publish that magazine Udbodhan. What is the second reason Sharadananda used to quote? Second, Sharadananda wished to publish an accurate and complete account of Sri Ramakrishna's life. Otherwise, other people, miracle mongers and other people, instead of writing the actual life of Ramakrishna, yes, there were so many miracles, so many things which have happened, and they would go on only for that, and that would mislead the devotees. So Sharadananda wanted to write authentic, publish an accurate and complete account of Sri Ramakrishna's life. That was the second reason. As an editor of Udbodhan, that Bengali magazine, he had to correct and rewrite many articles about Sri Ramakrishna that were full of misinformation. Because Sharadananda was an eyewitness to Sri Ramakrishna's life, he could not bear that any untruth be told about Sri Ramakrishna. Third reason for writing the book was Ramakrishna, the great master. Third reason was he tried to justify the philanthropic activities of Sri Ramakrishna mission. Third reason for writing the book Ramakrishna, the great master, is he tried to justify the philanthropic social activities of Ramakrishna mission and also remove the misunderstanding about Sri Ramakrishna's teaching. People were always telling Ramakrishna told about Vairagya, renunciation, give up everything in the name of God and think of God. He never told about the social service. He never told about Karma Yoga. Why are you people doing this? Is all Maya. So people used to go against the work done by the monks of Ramakrishna order as commanded by Swami Vivekananda. So Sharadananda wanted to show that they are not antagonistic to the teachings of Ramakrishna. Ramakrishna has told that these things. Third, Sharadananda ji Maharaj tried to justify that philanthropic activities of Ramakrishna mission and also remove the misunderstanding about Sri Ramakrishna's teaching. Serve human beings as God. Shiva Gnane Jiva Seva. Serve human beings as God. Yam, who was Yam? Mahendranath Gupta, the recorder of Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, had once, as a householder devotee, commented that the monastic disciples changed the focus of master's teaching, which according to Yam Mahendranath Gupta was God realization and not social service. Of course, Master Mahashay Yam had to later change his mind in 1912 when Holy Mother Sharda Devi visited the Ramakrishna Mission home of service in Varanasi, Kashi, and said, seeing the service activity done there to the poor people in the hospital of Ramakrishna home of service in Varanasi, Holy Mother, when she visited that place, she was so happy. She remarked, seeing that service, the master is ever present in this place, and because of the service taken up for the poor people, Mother Sharda Devi told that Sri Ramakrishna is always present in this place. And Mother Lakshmi always casts her benign glance upon it. Whenever you do service, wherever and whenever you do service to humanity, seeing God in the humanity, in the poor people, service to human beings as service to God, with this attitude when you serve, what is going to happen? Mother Sharda Devi has told. Not only Master Ramakrishna, who is Narayana himself or Vishnu himself, ever present in that place where the philanthropic activity or the service activity, seeing God in man and being served, and also Mother Lakshmi always casts a benign glance upon it. Once Girish Chandra Ghosh had asked Vivekananda to write a biography of Sri Ramakrishna. You are the right person. You knew, you understood Ramakrishna rightly, properly. So you are the right person to write a biography of Ramakrishna. When Girish Chandra Ghosh requested Swami Vivekananda to write a biography of Ramakrishna, Swami Vivekananda declined. He was afraid, expressing his inability. Shall I make the image of a monkey while trying to make the image of Shiva? Somebody went to make the image of Lord Shiva. While making the image of Lord Shiva, instead he made an image of a monkey. So if I go to write the biography of Ramakrishna, I may do this mistake. Shall I make the image of a monkey while trying to make that of Shiva? On another occasion, Swami Vivekananda said, Sharat, that is Sharadananda, will write the biography of Sri Ramakrishna. He has been brought down by master to do that work. He is the fit person. He is the person who has understood Ramakrishna rightly. Sharat will do this work of writing the biography of Ramakrishna. Later, Girish Chandra asked Sharadananda to write about Sri Ramakrishna's divine play, his sadhana, spiritual practices, and his teaching message. Otherwise, in the future, some less adept people might present Sri Ramakrishna in a narrow, incorrect way, which might eventually form a cult and defeat the purpose of the incarnation of Lord Vishnu. If you don't write, you are the right person, you understood him, you have seen him, you are a realized soul, you are a fit person. If you don't write it now, then in future, a person who is not adept, who may not be having such vast heart like you, vast spiritual experience like you, and he may show Ramakrishna in a narrow way, and that might be the reason for creating a cult which would go against Hinduism, the tenets of Hinduism. So it will become a cult, and that would defeat the purpose of the incarnation of the Lord. So Girish Chandra Ghosh one day told Sharadananda to write Sri Ramakrishna's divine play, divine life, his sadhana, and his message. Otherwise, in the future, some less adept people might present Sri Ramakrishna in a very narrow way, incorrect way, which might eventually form a cult and defeat the purpose of his incarnation. There was cause for such apprehension. It was well known that Girish had given his power of attorney to Sri Ramakrishna, who took complete responsibility for Girish Chandra Ghosh. Ramakrishna had taken the power of attorney of Girish Chandra Ghosh, and he did all for Girish. Some people began to imitate this and deceive themselves. They started imitating Girish Chandra Ghosh. They didn't understand the spirit. They couldn't understand the essence of what is this power of attorney. So later on, people began to imitate this and deceive themselves because they did not understand the importance of self-surrender. They did not know what is self-surrender is. Sharadananda first wrote. That's why Sharadananda first wrote Sri Ramakrishna as a Guru. That was published first. The third and fourth parts of Leela Prasanga was written first. Sri Ramakrishna as a Guru. Sharadananda first wrote Sri Ramakrishna as a Guru, which in reality is the third and fourth part of the Ramakrishna, the great master, Leela Prasanga, and then wrote the rest. You can now understand why Sharadananda wrote Leela Prasanga in this way, or the great master in this way. In the beginning of the third part, Sharadananda explained the mystery of the power of attorney. So he took up this subject in the beginning itself, and then he has completely given the detail of this power of attorney. Sharadananda explained the mystery of power of attorney that the master had accepted from Girish. Before publication, Sharadananda read the chapter to Girish, and Girish Chandra Ghosh wholeheartedly accepted and approved it. So you see how the Leela Prasanga, the great master life, has been written. It is just not concoction or imagination of the author. He wrote it when the person himself, Girish Chandra Ghosh, who had given the power of attorney And ask Sharadananda to write about it. He took up that first so that people should not be misled. And he wrote about it and showed it to Girish Chandra Ghosh. And after taking the approval, then only inserted this into the life. So you can now understand how the biography of Ramakrishna has been recorded by Sharadananda. So he has met each and every person, the disciple of Ramakrishna, and he has got the first-hand experience, and then he has inserted all those things into the life. So you can now understand how authentic and how accurate and how historical everything in chronology, perfectly the life of Ramakrishna has been written. It is never unhistorical or unscientific. It has been perfectly recorded. So that is the wonder of the great master Sri Ramakrishna, which we have completed recently. So even here you can see, after writing that, he took approval. He read it to Girish Chandra Ghosh, who is the hero of that particular subject, Power of Attorney. And then after Girish Chandra Ghosh wholeheartedly approved it, then only that was put into the life of Ramakrishna. Once a monk asked Sharadananda to write a life of Ramakrishna that would contain all the stories about him. To which Sharadananda replied, "Is it so easy to write about Sri Ramakrishna? One should not undertake such work without having the command of the Lord. Is it so easy to write the life and other things about Ramakrishna? One should not undertake such a work without having his command." That means Sharadananda had the command of God to write the life of Ramakrishna. If I get his command, I shall try. If the Lord commands me, then I will try to write the life of Ramakrishna. Some years later, when Leela Prasanga of Ramakrishna, the great master, was published, the same monk went to Sharadananda and asked him, "Swamiji, you have completed the work now, Leela Prasanga or Ramakrishna the great master. Have you received the command before writing this book?" To which Sharadananda avoided the question, saying, "That is none of your business. Why should I tell you?" Sharadananda was avoiding. He would not answer. When that same monk again went and questioned Sharadananda, "You have finished the work of Ramakrishna's life, writing the life, the great master. Whether Sharadananda had received the command before writing the book?" Sharadananda avoided the question, saying, "That is none of your business." One day, Asitananda, the attendant of Sharadananda, worked up the courage to ask Swami Sharadananda if he had experienced Nirvikalpa Samadhi, the highest experience in spiritual life is Nirvikalpa Samadhi, which Ramakrishna used to frequently go to ecstasis. Always we have seen that. So one of his attendant is asking Sharadananda. He worked up the courage to ask Swami Sharadananda if Sharadananda had experienced Nirvikalpa Samadhi. To which Sharadananda replied, "Did I waste my time cutting grass, that is living meaninglessly, when I lived in the company of Sri Ramakrishna?" Replied Sharadananda to that. Did I waste my time cutting grass when I lived in the company of Sri Ramakrishna? I had got Nirvikalpa Samadhi by doing sadhana and by the grace of my Guru Ramakrishna. Even when Ramakrishna lived, at that time itself I got that Nirvikalpa Samadhi, the highest. Do you think I was cutting grass and wasting my time meaninglessly when I stayed and lived with Ramakrishna? Sharadananda replied in this way. When the attendant pressed, no, you have to tell directly, don't mention this indirectly. The attendant, the young monk, he pressed Sharadanandaji Maharaj for details. Then after he forced him or pressed him for that, then Sharadananda replied, read the chapter on Samadhi in Sri Ramakrishna, the great master. I have not written anything about Samadhi without experiencing it myself. When the Swami pressed and forced Sharadananda to reply directly, to which Sharadananda said, read the chapter on Samadhi in Sri Ramakrishna, the great master. I have not written anything in that book about Samadhi without first myself experiencing it. So everything in the book, whatever he has told about Ramakrishna, first Sharadananda would meditate and get that experience himself and then write that in the book. He has not written anything on imagination or hearsay. So Sharadananda would first experience it himself and then write in the book. So whatever Ramakrishna, whatever experiences Sri Ramakrishna had, Sharadananda had it first himself, first hand, and then he has written it. Not one experience of Sri Ramakrishna has Sharadananda written in the great master without himself first experiencing it. I have not written anything about Samadhi without experiencing it myself. So that was the greatness of Sharadananda. Christopher Isherwood, the author of Ramakrishna and his disciples, wrote, although Sharadananda did not begin his work until more than 20 years after Sri Ramakrishna's passing away, there is no doubt of its authenticity. Many of those who had known Ramakrishna were then still alive. And Sharadananda carefully compared his memories with theirs. The great master has also the value of having been written by a monastic disciple who had actually shared the extraordinary experiences he describes. Nothing beyond my spiritual experience has been recorded in this book, The Great Master. Sharadananda once told a questioner, this seemingly cautious answer is in fact a claim to tremendous. This seemingly cautious answer is in fact a claim so tremendous that it silences all suspicion of boastfulness. A man like Sharadananda could not have made it unless it was literally true. Having the permission and blessing from Holy Mother Sharada Devi, Sharadananda began to write Sri Ramakrishna Leela Prasanga, or it's called as Great Master Sri Ramakrishna. In Bengal, it is called Sri Sri Ramakrishna Leela Prasanga. That is Ramakrishna's divine play. Sharadananda collected all information about Holy Mother Sharada Devi in the book directly from her. When the mother was in Calcutta, Sharadananda used to read the manuscript to her as it was then published serially in the Udbodhan. When she was in Jairambati, the birthplace of Holy Mother Sharda Devi, someone else would read it to her. Then Holy Mother Sharda Devi would comment. She commented, "Everything has been written correctly by Sharad's book." Once a learned disciple of Holy Mother Sharda Devi said, "Mother, what a wonderful book Shardananda Maharaj has written." To which Holy Mother Sharda Devi replied, "Yes, it needs learning and intellect to understand Sharad's book." Sharad's means Shardananda. In 1925, during the chariot festival of Puri Jagannatha Rathayatra, 1925, Shardananda talked about the adverse condition in which he wrote Leela Prasanga in Udbodhan. Holy Mother was living upstairs along with Radhu. I was surrounded by devotees, and all the relatives, most of the relatives of Holy Mother lived with her upstairs. There would be so much of noise. All that relatives would be talking, and here below there were so many devotees coming, hundreds of devotees. Holy Mother Sharda Devi was living upstairs with Radhu. Sharadananda ji is telling, "Below, I was surrounded by devotees, and I had to keep the accounts also, the whole of Udbodhan and the magazine and everything of the ashrama, of not only Udbodhan but of the Belur Math, of the whole order, the accounts and the activities, the administration has to be looked after by Sharadananda. Hundreds of devotees around him, accounts, all the execution of all the activities of Ramakrishna order. He was the executive head. So I had to keep accounts also. The burden of the loan for the house was on me. I used to write Ramakrishna, the great master, Leela Prasanga, sitting in this small room downstairs with all these distractions around me. Then when I was writing the book with so much of focus and concentration in that room, surrounded by hundreds of devotees with all the workload upon me, when I was writing that book, then nobody dared to talk to me, as I had no time to chat for a long time. If anybody would ask anything, I would say, 'Be quick,' and finish the talk briefly. People would think that I was egoistic. I could not write much about the devotee except Gopal's mother and Vivekananda, because there was so much material to write about Sri Ramakrishna. When the mind was ready, only then could I write." The Bhagavad Gita says, "He who finds action in inaction," it's called Naishkarmya Siddhi. Bhagavad Gita says, the Lord Krishna tells in Bhagavad Gita, "He who finds activity, he who finds action in inaction, and inaction in action, is a perfect yogi." What is this? The statement itself is paradoxical. Could you understand this wonderful teaching of Sri Krishna? He who finds action in inaction, how can you find action in inaction? And he who finds inaction in action, how can you find inaction in action? So Lord Krishna is telling, he is a perfect yogi. The same thing Swami Vivekananda used to command his disciples and the Swamis of Ramakrishna order. "This moment, you should be ready to meditate, sit here and meditate. The next moment, you should be ready to go to the garden and till the field there and grow the garden, dig the garden, ready, make the garden. The next moment, you should go to the kitchen, cut the vegetables, cook. The next moment, you should be ready to sweep, mop, do all the menial services, clean the toilet. The next moment, you should be ready to go to the garden, taking all the produce of the vegetables and sell there in the market. And again, the next moment, you should be coming, should come and sit and meditate. So this state of mind, which is ready for everything, that is action and inaction and inaction and action. What is that? Can we be a little more elaborate? Now, while you are meditating, it is the highest action. So when you are working, your energy is frittering away. When you are going outside and doing all those things, chit-chatting, you are wasting so much of your energy. But in meditation, you have to control the mind, which is trying to rush away. It is not under your control. So with great effort, with great, the highest effort, you have to control it. So that is the highest activity. So that is the most strongest activity, the highest activity of controlling the mind and meditating on God. So in samadhi, or when you completely, totally merge in yourself in God, you have to do the highest activity of controlling the mind perfectly. So there is highest activity in inactivity. In meditation on God, you have the highest activity, action, inaction, inaction. Then while you go out after this meditation, when you have reached the highest goal, when you have this concentration, when you have realized the goal, then when you go to any activity, whichever you do, it may be the busiest, you may be selling the produce in the market, you may be mopping, you may be sweeping, you may be doing any menial work, cutting the wood, tilling. But with this experience, now you can find inactivity in activity. You can be calm and quiet. Your mind can be concentrated and focused. There will be no distraction. So that is inactivity in activity. So I think you could get that to some extent. So the Bhagavad Gita says, he who finds action in inaction, that is called as Naishkarmya Siddhi, and inaction in action, he is a perfect yogi. That is the perfection in Karma Yoga. So that person is called a perfect yogi. So this shloka or the verse in Bhagavad Gita is the fourth verse in the 18th chapter, amidst 4:18, amidst the hectic surroundings and crowds. So Sharadananda had achieved this teaching. He had become a perfect yogi. He had realized God. So that's why, in spite of all the activity, on the top, service of Holy Mother and her relatives, below in the ground floor, hundreds of devotees, then accounts of Udbodhan, accounts of that thing, he had to repay the loan. So for that weight of repaying the loan is there. The executive work, as a general secretary, he has to do all the activity of Ramakrishna, whole order, Ramakrishna Math and Mission. And in that mind, he has to write this wonderful book. So perfect concentration, in spite of the busiest schedule, because he had realized he was a perfect yogi, he had attained this Naishkarmya Siddhi given by the perfection in yoga, as given by Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita. He who finds action in inaction and inaction in action, he is a perfect yogi. 4:18, words of Lord Krishna. Amidst the hectic surroundings and crowds, Sharadananda continued his serious writing project. One day, some young monks were talking loudly and laughing in the Udbodhan office, adjacent to Swami Sharadananda's room. Golapma, an attendant of Holy Mother, scolded that monks. Shame on you. Mother is upstairs. She is resting. And Sharadananda is doing his serious work of writing the book, and you boys are making so much of great noise, overhearing Golappa's loud voice. Sharadananda said to her, "Well, Golappa, please don't give your ears to them. Why are you bothered about those boys making noise? It is the nature of these young boys to behave like that. I am so close to them, but I don't listen to what they are talking. I am not at all disturbed. I am so close here. You are upstairs. The noise which you hear is very less, but I am very close to them. I am by their side. And even though if they are so boisterous and noisy, I am so close to them. I don't listen and I am not disturbed to what they are talking about. So what have I done? Do you know? I have told my ears, my dear ears, don't listen to anything that is unnecessary. My dear ears, only focus on the work. So my ears obey my command. My mind obeys my command. My ears, senses obey my command. They will not give their mind, that senses would not go to that thing at all. I have told them my senses, the ears, don't listen to anything that is unnecessary. So my ears are not listening to them." Sharadananda had total control over his senses. What a wonderful thing. Have you noticed? Perfect control of the senses. Shama, Dama, Uparati, Titiksha, everything, whatever is recorded in the Viveka Chudamani, the Shamadi Shatka Sampatti, Viveka, Vairagya, every character, every guna quality in perfection could be seen in Sharadananda. He's telling, "I've told my mind, do not hear unnecessary things. Concentrate on your work. My ears doesn't go there at all." So that was a wonderful control, sense control, Indriya Nigraha and Mano Nigraha of Sharadananda. So he was not at all bothered. So you should remember the story of Ramakrishna. But if I go to tell that story of Ramakrishna from the gospel, it will take another 5 minutes. We have already completed our time. So I'll stop my conversation here with this high note of perfect control, a perfect yogi, action in inaction, and inaction in action, Naishkarmya Siddhi. Actionlessness, completely perfected. Such is the mastery of yoga. You will be intensely active in meditation and you will be intensely calm in your activity, in all the busiest activity. And that is what you can see Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is doing. Perfect example of that particular verse or teachings of Sri Krishna. And perfect example of Indriya Nigraha, Shama, Dama, Uparati, Titiksha. All that qualities you can see manifested in Sharadananda in a wonderful way. And now we can understand all these things, without which I think it would be just confusion. If somebody is not practicing it, you cannot see it. And you can see here life, firsthand experience. So it was wonderful to hear that control, perfect control, Mano Nigraha, Indriya Nigraha. So we will continue to study Sharadananda maybe in another, for another 4 or 5 classes. We'll be studying this wonderful character. So let us meditate, let us think, read again and again, and get that wonderful quality. We have to emulate that. We have to internalize all these things. So if you have any questions, if you have any doubts on what we have discussed today, you are free to ask. Are there any questions on the live chat?
Hari Om, Swamiji.
Hari Om, Kalanji.
Thank you, Swamiji. So many things that we've learned, the significance and of why and how we do pranams. Thank you for reminding us of why we do these pranams, the various types of pranams. That was, thanks for that reminder. But more importantly, Swamiji, is the Holy Mother, she was not formally educated, and yet we had highly educated persons like Sri Sharadanandaji Maharaj and Swami Vivekananda, who had the greatest of devotion to the Holy Mother. Why was this so? She was not formally educated. These Swamis were highly educated. How did she manage to demonstrate her holiness?
Now, your question itself is the answer. Who is she? Because she is the one who gives education to all of us. Sharada Devi is Mother Saraswati herself, the incarnation of Saraswati, Sharada. So why does she need education? She is the one who gives education to all of us. And what education can we give her? And what can the world give her? She is the source of all education. We pray to Mother Sharada for education. So she is the incarnation of that. So what education does he need? And is also the proof to show that whatever we are getting, education is not collection of information or facts, but education is already there within us. All that is, the knowledge is already within every one of us. The process is only uncovering of that. Whatever we study in the book, whatever we learn in the college, whatever we learn in the lab, we do is only a suggestion to uncover the wheel, removing the wheel of ignorance, which is covering the knowledge already within us. This itself is a proof. So we need not get education from outside. It is inside out, not outside in. So education is the manifestation of perfection, which is already within man. It is not collection of information. That is what Swami Vivekananda tells. So she has perfected that by sadhana, and she has removed that wheel of ignorance. So what does she need all these things? Why does she need? She is the source of all knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Swamiji.
Yes, Kulanj.
Om Swamiji.
Yes.
Swamiji, it's a practical question, and the answer is very probably very simple, and however, it's just a thought that I'd like clarified. How does it work practically, Swamiji? The Lord is incarnated and exists here, manifests as Shishada Devi, and then still exists as Mother Saraswati. Ramakrishna, Sri Ramakrishna is here, and he exists as himself and every avatar, which also exists at the same time. How does it work, Swamiji?
What do you mean by omnipotent? What is the meaning of omnipotent? Please, can you please explain what is omnipotency?
Swamiji, I'll have to check, but just
no,
breaking
no,
up the word.
Omnipotent means all powerful.
All powerful.
He has all the power. If you claim God is all powerful, if you tell God is omnipotent, all powerful, if you don't mean that, if God is all powerful, do you think he cannot do this? If you telling how, means you are not believing in the omnipotency of God. Is there anything impossible to God? That's why he's called God. Why are we called human beings? Because it's impossible for us at this stage. We think so, apparently. But we call him God because he is all powerful. He can do anything and everything. When Ramakrishna tells you the story that Narada Maharshi was going to Vaikuntha and two yogis asked him, please report us back while coming back, what is Lord Vishnu doing there in Vaikuntha? So while coming back after visiting Vaikuntha, one of the yogis, he told, see, what was my Vishnu doing? Oh, your Lord was taking one camel and trying to cross it from the eye of the needle, from this side to that side. He was taking that camel from this side to that side and that side to this side. Then that yogi told, oh, it's highly impossible. You have never gone to Vaikuntha and you are telling a lie. Okay, Narada Maharshi went away. He came to the next yogi and he asked him, oh, what is my Lord Vishnu doing there in Vaikuntha? He gave the same answer. Oh, the Lord was taking the camel through the eye of the needle from this side to that side. When he heard it, he started jumping, shouting and laughing and enjoying it. Yes, yes, nothing is impossible to God. God can do it. God can do it. Everything is true. Everything is true. He started shouting and jumping and joyfully proclaiming his, yes, God can do everything. God is all powerful. So it's your faith. God is all powerful. He can do anything and everything. If a human being, Swami Vivekananda tells you, have that Atman, you are all powerful, you can do anything and everything, do you think God cannot do it? That is omnipotency. So there is one more question on the live chat. That is Srivas. Om Namo Narayanaya, Divine Mother, if she wills, can give all her children Viveka, Vairagya in an instant. Why then she is involving most of her ignorant children in her Maya, suffering in this endless cycle? So the first answer is, I have to give this answer in two stages. The first answer for your question, if she wills, she can give all her children Viveka Vairagya in an instant. Why then she is involving most of her ignorant children in Maya? So in an instant she can give it, yes. Ramakrishna's story in Gospel is, all the children in their summer vacation or in vacation, they go to the grandmother's house. So there will be 10 or 15 or 20 children in the with the granny, and granny will be playing with them, hide and seek. So in India, that hide and seek has a different connotation. In the Western country, the hide and seek is different. So here in the Indian connotation, the grandmother will catch hold of one child and close her eyes like this, and they will sing some song. In different states or vernacular language, there will be different song for that. And while all the other children will run and they will escape and hide here and there. Then after singing that song, the grandmother will open the eyes. And this girl, child has to go and search all the other people. By the time she searches, if the other children who are hiding comes and touch the granny, then they will not be out. It is called out, or that in English they call it out. So the granny doesn't like that everybody will come and touch her, because if everybody comes and touches her in the game will stop. You have come to play. All the children have come to the granny's house to play the game and enjoy the life for the vacation. And now if everybody comes and touches the granny, the game will stop. So the granny doesn't want that the game should stop. So she will not allow all of them to touch her. So she will proceed the game. The game goes on, continues, because she wants to give amusement. Like that, we were in that higher world. We are the spiritual being who have come. We are not earthly beings come here to this earth to have spiritual experience, but we are spiritual beings come here to this earth to have some earthly experience. So you decided it. I have decided it to take this body and come here. You have decided to come to this world and get into this Maya. It is not the Divine Mother who decided it. You decided it. If you decide this moment, give up your desires, you don't want this game, immediately you can end it. Everything will stop. But you want this, so it is continuing. You have come. So that is the first answer. The second answer is, you have asked the question, she is involving most of her ignorant children in her Maya, suffering in this endless cycle. Again, that also I will answer through Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, the teaching of Ramakrishna, where one devotee was asking Ramakrishna himself about all this Leela, what is happening, so much of suffering in this world, so much of trouble, so much of pain, so much of death. Then Ramakrishna told, it is all his play, Leela. Then the devotee was a little hurt and he told, oh, it is play to him, and for us it is all suffering. It is just like the usage in some of the Indian languages. For the cat, you know, when the cat catches the rat, After catching the rat, it will break the neck of the rat. Then it will allow the rat to run here and there. First, it will catch hold of it and break the neck. Then it will allow to run and here. So it can't move very fast. It cannot run into the hole of the rat. So it will be trying to run. Then it will beat it with its hand like this. It will beat it in this hand and it will play for some time. And then it will eat. So for the cat, it is play. For the rat, it is pranasankata, life-threatening. So what kind of play is this? So much of trouble for us, and for God it is play. So that was the question, that was the tone with that devotee asked. He was very much upset. What is this game for God? And for us it is so much of suffering. Then Ramakrishna replied to that, it doesn't come exactly at that place, it comes in another place in gospel. Only if you read gospel, you can connect all these things to your life. So there Ramakrishna tells, see, these are very terse and subtle things. Even if I tell you, you can't understand it, but there is no other way I'm going to answer that. So he assumes the question or takes up the question and answers it. What is that? You claim that God is partial. God is troubling all of us. God is torturing us with the punishment and with all these things, partiality. Some people are born blind, some people are born lame, some people are born unintelligent, and some other people are born with a silver spoon or a golden spoon. As soon as they're born in a rich family. Some people are born very healthy, some people are born with intelligence, with leadership. Some suffer, some enjoy. So what is this partiality? What is this? You call this as a game of God. So then Ramakrishna, this is the problem with you, isn't it? You are objecting because of this. Now understand, who is the person who is born with a silver spoon? Who is the person who is born in a poor family, in all the poor condition? Who is the person who is born in a lame, as a lame, in his birth, or a blind? Who is the person who is born as a healthy or a strong man as soon as he born? Who is enjoying in the rich? Who is enjoying in the poor? Who is suffering in the poor? Who is enjoying in the healthy person? Who is suffering in the sick person? It is the same Lord. Where is the question of partiality? When it is he who is suffering in the lame, in the blind. And who is asking this question? Why is Maya making us suffer? It is the same Lord within you too. Who is telling this to you? It is the same Lord sitting in my heart telling this. Who is all that hearing in this class, all these things, the questions, and this life has been studied? It is the same Lord in every one of you. The actor in every actor here, the person is present in all the actor is the Lord only. It is the Lord who is suffering, it is the Lord who is enjoying, it is the Lord who is in the blind suffering there, it is the Lord who is in the healthy man. Where is the question of partiality? Will you be partial to one eye and you will not be partial to another eye of your own body? Will you take care of the head portion very nicely and you will not take care of the hand portion? Will you be partial to your own body, parts of your body? So can God be partial? No, it is the Lord who is suffering in the form of you. So if you wish, you are the Lord, you are the Parabrahma Swarupa, you identified with that Atman, give up all your desires, vain desires. This moment you are free. You are liberated. You want this, you have come to have the earthly experience, you want to proceed, prolong this, and you are having it. Why are you blaming on Maya? Why are you blaming on God? It is you. You want to enjoy this, you are having it. You don't want it, this moment you can give up all the vain desires, you are free. You have that already within the freedom. Freedom is your birthright. It is already there within you. So you are always free. You are assumed now, apparently, that you are bound, that's all. Then one more question. Sarojini Raju, Pranam Swamiji, inaction, is it all the actions of Gnani knows it is happening in the body and mind, as he knows he's not the body and the mind? Yes, you'll be aware of everything. That is called mindfulness. Awareness, mindfulness. So just like Ramana Maharshi just like Turiyanandaji Maharaj, another direct disciple of Ramakrishna, while in Haridwar or somewhere else in Kashi, when he was being operated for the carbuncle on the back, the doctor wanted to give him the anesthesia to reduce the pain or not feel the pain. He told, no, there is no necessity. I will withdraw my mind from that part of the body. So you just operate it, remove that carbuncle. That was a big carbuncle on the back. It was being cut. The doctor didn't administer anesthesia. He started doing the surgery. There was not even a twitch on his face. He was just sitting gladly as if nothing is happening, as if some other part of a shirt or a cloth is being torn. He was not at all bothered. But the next time when the doctor came to dress the wound, he touched the wound, he shouted in pain. Then the doctor told him, I'm sorry. That day I operated without the anesthesia, so I thought you would not feel the pain. Then Turiyanandaji replied, no, my mind was there in that part of the body. So I felt the pain. Now I will withdraw my mind from that part of the body. Then you do whatever you want. Nothing will happen to me. So at will, they had so much a perfect control of the mind and the senses and the body. They identified with the Atman. They could be a Sakshi Bhava and witness, and they could do this. So by practice, Abhyasena tu Kaunteya Vairagya, Lord Krishna tells in Bhagavad Gita, by practice you can get everything. So bit by bit, all these years, for millions of years, millions of birth, 8.4 lakhs of birth, we identified with the body, we enjoyed this. So now suddenly we want to give up this attachment to the body. It will not happen so quickly because it has been habituated, samskara has been formed. So try and you will succeed in it. So abhyasa yena tu kaunteya and vairagya, abhyasa and vairagya, we can achieve it. Lord Krishna has promised it. So let us do the sadhana and we can also achieve that. In action, and action of the jnani. So anything, see, he can withdraw from any part of the body or any part of the work. So while meditating, the intensive action, while working, so calmness, both are there. So he's aware, mindfulness of the Atman, that is the Atman at all the time, mindfulness of the presence of God at all the time for the bhaktas. So that is the way out. Yeah, all the questions in the live chat has been exhausted. Any other questions here in the Google Live? Okay, if we don't have any questions, we can end today's Life of Sharadanandaji Maharaj with a prayer. Om Priyatam Pundarikakshaha सर्वयज्ञेश्वरो हरिः तस्मिन् तुष्टे जगत्तुष्टं प्रीणिते प्रीणितं जगत् हरिः ओम तत्सत् श्रीरामकृष्णार्पणमस्तु नमस्ते थैंक यू ओम नमो नारायणाय